LaCrea, the God of peace, that's who we serve. The enemy is already crushed under our feet. Sometimes we just need to remind ourselves. So I've just been praising God all week because we have the victory. Amen. Let me get these slides up. I don't know. They'll come up. But and that's why I said, okay, should I have the song before the word? Am I kind of letting the cat out of the bag? But I know that y'all already know that we got the victory. It's not a hidden secret. We have the victory. We have the word that tells us so. Amen? Amen. But sometimes we got to remind ourselves. Sometimes we have a tendency to let the cares of the world, things that are going on in our life, in our families, it'll distract us. Almost like, what do they call it when the moon and the sun cross over? Eclipse. Depending on where you're at, you see that happen at different times. But it's what you're looking at. It's the lens through what you're looking at. So now this, but the sun is still there. The moon is going to pass. The sun has not moved. Amen. The sun. God is the same then, now, and forever. Amen. Regardless of what it might look like in this moment. So we're going to get into the word. Who is the referee here? Some of y'all watch sports. Who watch sports? Y'all into sports? Okay, we got some sports in here. Okay. And so we're going to get into it because I think sometimes you think you're the referee. And I say you, but I got this first, okay? So I've already had the, I think I'm the referee, and God has dealt with that. Where am I thinking that I am the referee in my life? So we're going to get into some of these questions. Today's outline, we're going to explore how life's discouragements and disappointments, sin and dysfunction can cause us to disqualify ourselves from walking in God's calling. If we let them become our identity, that's where the issue occurs. But however, God has the final say. Amen? We're going to get into it. Have you made the wrong call? Have you allowed life or family or any other tool the devil can use in your life to have you giving the wrong things referee power in your life? You know, you watch sports, you watch games, you watch different things, and I know some of y'all have yelled at the referee. I might be a little ashamed to admit at the toddler basketball game. Well, they're not toddler now, but they ate. If this ref, okay, no, just me? All right. But when they make the bad call, that could affect the whole game. Now, if you're an athlete, you know what I'm talking about. You've been training, you've been working, you've been giving it everything you got. For somebody to make a bad call and affect your whole game? All right, we're going to get into it. We're going to find the answers to these questions. We're going to learn who the only ref ought to be in our life. The only one who gets to make the call in our lives is God himself. Not you, not me, not mama and them, although I'm sure it's wise to listen to mama and them. I'm not going to tell you to go against mama and them. I don't want no problems. But ultimately, God himself. We're going to learn today, there are scriptures. Y'all, come on now, back row. They were with me. Now we all go to, there are scriptures. Boy, we're going to get into it. We're going to look at the book of Genesis, if you have your Bibles. Get ready there. And Exodus. To glean what we can through the lives and the lens of Moses and Joseph. So, let me see where I want my video. We're going to ask a couple of questions. Who are you? This is a question that I had for you to ask yourself. Who are you? Now, if I gave you 30 seconds to kind of start writing down who you are, who am I, and you started answering that, a lot of us might start to jot down things like what we do for a living. I'm an x-ray tech, I'm a teacher, I'm a husband, I'm a wife, other hats that we wear. We tend to say, when someone asks you who you are, we tend to associate that with things that we do or have done, good or bad for that matter. One might say, I'm a baseball player, I'm a mom, I'm a wife, I'm a school teacher. Other labels or titles may not necessarily feel as good. You may say, I am struggling with certain things. There may be struggles in our life, but we associate that as our identity. So although you may struggle with alcoholism, you might have labeled yourself, I'm an alcoholic. There's a difference between something we do and who we are. There's a difference between something that's been done to us as well and who we are. So we're going to get into the difference in those things. The second question was, now you got to ask God who you are. Okay? I think we spend a lot of time on question number one trying to ask ourselves, trying to think about who we are, who we think we should be, where we've been, what's happened to us. We can even get into a victim type of mindset. We can be angry. We can be bitter. We can be a lot of things if we're asking ourselves. But if we turn and we turn that to God for our identity, we'll see that it's going to be quite different, because when God tells us who we are, he speaks to what we're made of. He speaks to what he's already put in us before he knit us together in our mother's womb. And those things, what he created, what he purposed, what he placed in us, nothing on earth can deter that. No circumstance can erase your purpose. Nothing that someone's done to you, nothing that you've done can erase your purpose in God. He speaks to his creative design for us. He speaks to our being. We speak about what we're doing. Remember that. So the problem with wrapping up our identity in what we do is that we pay less attention to who we are. We start to get caught up in what we do. And guess what? If what we do doesn't quite go so well, that can leave us devastated too if we've got our identity in what we do. The market crashed. You had all these businessmen killing themselves, committing suicide because their identity was in what they were doing. So when then that crashed, they crashed. They weren't anchored. They didn't have an anchor. That can happen to any one of us if we put our anchor in the wrong things. Who we are ought to influence what we do. We heard the babies singing up here, because of what Jesus did on Calvary, they lift their hands. That's cause and effect. Because of who God is to us, it ought to affect our being. Who we are ought to influence what we do, but we do it the other way around. We let what we do or want to do influence who we're going to be. Well, in order for me to be and do this, I have to be this way. I gotta dress like this. I gotta do this and this, because that's the expectation of what I wanna be and do. Wrong. I should have brought a whistle. I could have been a little referee on that one. Wrong. So we're going to get into it, but before we go there, so we're going to look at, yes, this is the order. So we're going to look at disqualify, the definition of disqualify. When I opened, I started talking about we get a tendency to want to be the referee in our own life. We want to tell ourselves when we're disqualified, you know, sometimes in that realm, oh, you did something wrong. You stepped out of bounds. You done blew the whistle, called yourself out. You didn't even get three strikes. At least in baseball, you get three strikes. You can get yourself one strike and you're out. Out the game, out the life, out the marriage, out the church, out the Sunday school. The boy stayed in Sunday school 15 years with them little babies. But we make one mistake, we will count ourselves out. That's why we're not the ref. That's exactly why we are not the ref. To disqualify means to declare ineligible for an office, activity, or competition because of an offense or infringement. A feature or characteristic which makes someone unsuitable for an office or activity. How many of us, if we're honest, we felt unsuitable for something that we know God has called us to? I see hands going up, so there's honesty happening in the room. I definitely have felt unsuitable, less than. Who am I to do XYZ? Me? Never. We're going to get into that. And we're going to look at disqualifying. So I wanted to play a video to show us this concept of refereeing, disqualification. How does it feel to be disqualified? And just kind of the role of referees and this kind of thing. So let's see if we can see this first clip.
Second Frenchman in the lineup, Christophe Lemaitre.
Usain Bolt.
Oh no, the whole crowd will go.
Wow,
false start.
Usain Bolt. Massive disappointment. And he knows it too. The vest came straight off.
The whole of the photographers who assembled at the finish ready to celebrate the moment.
Everyone watching.
Have now run down to the beginning of the race. He's whisked his shirt off immediately. He knows what he's done. When it came to the big moment, he's looked so impressive in the preliminary rounds here. And it's just not going to be for Usain Bolt, because surely he was away well clear of the rest of the field.
So what do they
in
do?
This year's
they watch the playback.
100 meter world championship final. No doubt about the culprit there. Dan Bailey went with him. That's the first time I've ever seen
Look
Usain Bolt false start.
I think he was trying for a magnificent performance, and we expect so much from him. That's what it is. He could have got an ordinary start and still won this race, but he wanted to produce something special, I think, and that's what caused it. What an absolute shame. I mean, this is going to make the headlines all over the world.
You can stop
Unfortunately,
it.
Unfortunately for the one that actually wins it today.
So we see the frustration. Imagine that you trained for a year to run this race. You got everybody talking about you. Have you ever had everybody talking about you? Have you ever been in the spotlight? It's not always a comfortable feeling. All right. Then you're in front of all these people. The world is watching. And you false start. If you saw his face, he screamed in frustration, tore his shirt off in frustration because of that false start. I thought, man, they only get one false start? In the past, you used to get two or three, or at certain competitions, you may get two or three, you get another chance. But no, he was out of that race. This is Usain Bolt, who is now now the fastest man in the world. Can we imagine if he would have stopped? That was in 2011. If he would have let that disqualification get to him, stop running, stop training, be bitter. I can't believe this. They could have gave me another chance. All of these things that we tell ourselves. He could have counted himself out. He could have threw in the towel. He could have been angry at the sport, at the refs, at the this, at the that. Cut it. Left the church because I was upset. Make it make sense to you. Maybe you don't run track, right? But one false start and you're out of there. So in sports, they watch the playback to determine if they made the right call. So now they're playing it back. People can watch your false start over and over and over again. Imagine that. If we did the same, though, and we wanted to watch the playback, instead of seeing our sin and our dysfunction and our shortcomings and our false starts, do you know what, by the grace of God, we would see? We would see Jesus Christ hanging for our sins. We would see Jesus Christ taking our place. The mercy of God covering us, his grace, every day, so he can wipe those false starts out of the record, and nobody's not sending your YouTube videos to everybody talking about you and trying to tear you down. Because guess what? In God, I am a new thing. I am a new creation. I am not my false starts of the past. So now we're going to look at this second video. Because he did not allow himself to stay down to let that disqualification count him out. Instead, he came back in 2012. Now, 2011 was a world championship where he false started. 2011 is the Olympics. So your last race was a false start, and you're now on the biggest stage of your career in the world. Just think about how you would feel. Might be a little intimidating. But now, do we have that second video? Okay, great. We're gonna see what happened.
On your mark.
He says, shh. When it's time to race, are you silencing the enemy? Are you tuning your voice to the voice God?
Set.
Oh, they're away, and Gatling got away brilliantly, and he's ahead of the field at the moment, and Bolt going very near. Here comes Usain Bolt! Usain Bolt storming through, he takes it again, Blake gets the silver, 9.64! Oh, he's retained his title in the most emphatic way! Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant! Usain Bolt of Jamaica is the fastest man on the planet, 9.63! A superb demonstration of power sprinting. What a performance that was.
All right. World record. We are not what we have done. If he allowed what he did to be his identity, then he would have been a failure, a false starter. No, that was just something that happened. Who I am is a champion. Who I am is a man of God, a woman of God. Who I am is an overcomer. Who I am is who God says I am. But if he even let what people said about him be his identity, did you hear the sportscaster when he false started? Oh, man. Oh, failure. You can look at his face and see the frustration. He's out of here. Oh, all of that. Same people, when you win, they're still talking about you. Either way, they're going to talk. We got to be able to have earmuffs on that stuff. Who cares? Good or bad, you're not giving me my identity. But some of us live for the praises of man. So if we don't get praised by somebody, we don't feel good about ourselves. Oh, maybe I didn't do a good job. Maybe I'm not enough. Maybe I should sit down. He did not let the good or the bad affect his identity. I'm who I am because God says who I am. I'm going to train like I am who God says I am. I'm going to prepare like I am who God says I am. I'm going to live. I'm going to dress. I'm going to walk like who I am in God. Not based on what nobody has to say about it. 2008 was when he first made his Olympic appearance. 2011 was when he did that false start. 2012, 16, 20, 24, breaking all the records, holds the record in 100, 200, broke the relay race record. Did not allow what happened to become who he was. Amen? Amen? So we're going to get into this because it doesn't matter if you had a false start, no start. Somebody's sitting here like, I didn't have a false start, but I really haven't started doing too much anything yet. Now, listen. You might kind of be fairly new if that's you and you feel like you haven't got any start because, new creation, we've been at this thing now all year, picking up our cross, carrying our cross. So we need to have made some advancement in our spiritual growth by July if we've been here since January and beyond. But now if I just came in or somehow I still hadn't quite got started. False start, no start. Then we got others. Well, all of us had a sinful start. Okay? Not any of us are sinless. Not even walking in Christ, you're going to fall, you're going to stumble. But as a disciple of Christ, the intention has got to be, I'm not going to sit in my sin. I'm not going to choose sin. I'm not comfortable in sin. I got to be taking some steps to change, to turn from my sinful ways. That may be boundaries. That may mean I need to change some places I'm going, some things I'm listening to, some stuff that I'm watching. We've been in this singles series. Pastor has been just tearing it up. Y'all all right? Okay. I'm just checking on us. But listen. It can feel like it's a big, maybe job or a heavy weight to walk with God, to choose holiness, to choose righteousness when everything else comes so easy and everything else is glorified and everything else is before us morning, day, and night. But we are called to be apart. We are called to be different. And that's the importance of fellowship. Some of us struggle so much because we're not partaking of the things that God has put in our life to build us up, to fortify our walk. I heard you say, I'm my brother and my sister's keeper. Are we? Do you care? When you look to your left and your right, do you care about the brother and sister sitting on that row? Because how you walk out your walk with God affects everybody around you. Everybody around you. Sometimes we're praying for things to change and people to change and in our families, in our lives. And God said, you're the change. You're the change. I put you there so they could see me through you. But are you doing that? We don't always understand what's at stake. And so it doesn't matter if we had a false start, no start, sinful start, painful start, abandonment start, addicted start, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. How are we going to finish? How are we going to finish? How are we going to run our race? How are we going to show back up and get in this thing? How are we going to walk with God? Because discouraged doesn't equal disqualified. Who you are comes from the word, relationship with God, and revelation. So this was kind of the, A was, who are you, when we started. B to that is, who are you? You see how it's different? Who are you? Who are you to disqualify you? It's the same three words. Who are you? Oh, I'm this, I'm that. No, who are you to disqualify you? When did you get the referee whistle and the stripes and all the, and who elevated you to that status? So in this concept of who's the referee, it doesn't matter. Good call, bad call. I found some referee videos, y'all, but people get a little irate, so I didn't want to play those. They had a few clips kind of strung together. They made some calls that were questionable, and boy, there was a lot of energy behind that. I said, this is a refereeing job. I wonder how much they get paid, because they might be risking it all out there making these calls. But then I also started to think about myself and times in my life that I've disqualified myself, that I put that referee hat on and have been very hard on myself at times. I've attempted to disqualify myself, whew, get a little emotional. As a mother, sometimes you're very hard on yourself. Did I make the right choice? You want the best. You want everything for your children. And none of us are perfect. I was talking with a friend of mine. I said, gee, you know what? At every stage of motherhood, I've never been here before. I've never been a mother of one child. And then two children, and then three children, or a teenager, but we don't give ourselves grace. So there's been times where I disqualify myself as a mother. As a single woman, before that I was married, I remember there was many times that I disqualified myself. Well, you've already been here or done that, so why try to be holy now? You let people talk about you. Now you're this, you're that, you already this, you're already that. So you have all these things in your mind, so you disqualify yourself. What's the point of it all? That's the enemy. That's the enemy want to talk you into who you used to be and try to keep you in that thing of who you did and what you are. We got to go to the word. We got to start to identify. It's spiritual. You got to recognize God's voice and any other voice, your own little raggedy referee voice, the world. Some people grew up in hostile environments, verbal abuse. You were torn down in your own home by the people who are supposed to love you the most, tore you down instead of building you up. You got to start to identify when those voices come back in your head trying to keep you stuck in those places. No, 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 no. I am who God says I am, period. Y'all like to say, period. Okay? As a single woman, yes, I got to spend time in God's word to learn. It was so pivotal. It was so pivotal that God pulled me to himself when I was saved and said, this next couple years is just going to be me and you. You don't even need to worry about dating nobody. You don't need to look at nobody, date nobody, none of that. It's me and you. At that time, I was newly saved. I hear some of y'all say, yes, amen. That wasn't me. What? Hold on, I'm new to this. Where does it say it, though? You said what book? What chapter is it? I don't even know. Is there an outline? I don't know about that. But what I did know from the moment that I was saved is this, I just wanted more of God. So I went to Sunday school, not the one that was up there, adult Sunday school. I went to Bible study. I started getting it. And when I tell you how God works with me, he's on my throat if I think I'm going left. And he said, go right. So every message was, you need to spend time with God. I'm trying to be like the Matrix. Oh, that wasn't for me. Was that for you? But I thank God that he's that way with me. The word says that he chastens those whom he loves. He corrects those whom he loves. And I needed that time with him and him alone to learn who God is first so I could learn who I was. So that when somebody came up in front of me, they couldn't mislead me. Pastor, what's the word you said the men were doing? Defraud. They couldn't defraud me. I know what a counterfeit looks like because I knew who God was then. But you could have defrauded me had I not taken that time to get to know God, his character, what it is to walk with him, what it looks like to have a real relationship with him, not just do things that can be looked at as checking that Christian box. Again, it's not what we do. If we focus on what we do or what somebody else does, we can get defrauded real easy. Because you can really act the part. You could be here every Sunday and not think twice about God from the moment you walk outside these doors the other 6 days of the week. So who are you then really? That's just mathematical. 1 out of 7 and 6 out of 7, that's a less than. So good calls, bad calls, even true calls I have on here, it doesn't matter because in the video, they made the right call. Yeah. It was a true call. He false started. In those other videos, they may have made the bad call, so they got a little bit of pushback. But they made the right call. So the calls they make may even be true about you. Maybe it's the right call. These things that people are saying, maybe it's true. I did this. I did that. I was there. These things did happen. But it's only the truth of God that matters because he will turn your false start into a fresh start. Amen? Making all things new. So it all comes back to the word of God. Who you are is who God says you are. Who does God say we are? Let's look at it. In Genesis 1:27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Our identity. We cannot get feelings confused with identity. Feelings come and go. Feelings change. Feelings exist based on external factors. This is our identity. I know that throughout this series as well, pastors touched on many subjects, even to the point of what a lot of people are struggling with in this day and age under the realm of homosexuality. Was I born this way? All these things that pastor touched on. And I know that God gave me an opportunity one time to really minister to someone who was going through this identity struggle. And they said something to me that really, really left an imprint on my heart. And they said to me, the only reason I reached out to you is because I saw you posting about celibacy. This is when I was single. God really spoke to me through this exchange that had happened. See, we like to point out what we see as other people's sin. But when we're looking at how we live our life, we all got sin. Some of y'all just hide it really well.
Yeah.
Dress it up real pretty. Tuck it up so nobody can see it. But it's when that we walk in our holiness and we don't do it apart from God, right? It's a striving.
Yes, Lord.
It is us becoming daily, daily, dying to sin, choosing to die to sin, choosing to turn away from it. But because I was sharing my walk on celibacy, this person's heart and spirit was open to hearing what God had to say. So in that time, I said, you know what? When we're looking at our identity, it can seem like a really big, overwhelming thing that we're trying to figure out about ourselves. But what simplifies it or has for me is just to learn God's word and then do what you learn. Just learn God's word and then just apply that. And then just learn more, keep being hungry, keep going back to it, and apply that. So regardless of what you're feeling in attractions to this or that, hey, attract yourself to the word. Attract yourself to the word so you can learn what God says about it. Don't do nothing with him, he, she, them, they, nobody. Get before the feet of God. That's where it's going to start. That's where we turn the false start, fresh start, sinful start, all these other starts, confused start, dysfunctional start, whatever the start is. If we want to get it turned around so we can have that fresh start, all we got to do is just get at his feet. Let God handle everything else. Stop trying to be the referee in your own life. John 10:10-12. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. You could just run your thoughts up against, is this thought going to lead to steal, kill, destroy? Or, if we continue in verse 10, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. So is this leading to abundant life or death? Period. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. He's given his life for you and for me. That's why our identity is in him. None of this stuff in the world ain't giving nothing for you, much less life. The thing about it is, both God, both the Lord, both our Heavenly Father and Satan want us to bring our discouragements to them. You see, Satan wants you to turn to him with your discouragement because he's going to rile you up. Yeah, that's right. They did do that to you. Oh, my gosh. You should feel angry. You should be mad. I would never talk to another sister again because all they're going to do is talk bad about you and gossip about you and try to tear you down. No, I wouldn't go to no woman's ministry. You know what happened the last time you went to women's ministry and what did and this and that. That's the enemy. He wants you to come bring every discouragement. It is as small as it could be. Somebody knocked your pen on the floor. I can't stand this church. These people are inconsiderate. They just wild, jumping up out of the seat, knock my stuff down. I'm out of here. And we laugh. But, dear God, so that is why we got to take it to the Lord. When we're discouraged, when we're hurt, when we're offended, we got to take it to the Lord. Sometimes, yeah, you have best friends, you have people, and I pray that they're wise. I pray that they're walking with God and they can lead you in wisdom as well. But we got to have our own relationship with God. We got to be able to hear his voice. We got to know what the word says about it. Because what God will do with our discouragement is turn it for our good. What God will do with our discouragement is actually grow us up inside of that thing. Well, when you got your pen knocked down, did you see the other trash on the floor? Did you pick that up? God will turn it back on us. Well, while you were down there, what did you see? What could you do differently next time? God will turn it around and have us looking at us in the situation so he can grow us up and that he can be glorified in and through us if we would just let him. But Satan wants to use that discouragement to paralyze you, have you bitter, just mean, cantankerous. Don't nobody want to be around you? Just walk in and people like, you don't want that. Don't let the enemy use you in that way. Break out of that. Go to God. 2 Corinthians 5:14-20. For the love of Christ controls and compels us. Because we have concluded this. The one died for all. Therefore all died. And he died for all so that all those who would live would no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for their sake. Does this describe you? That's a question for us to ask ourselves. Am I living for the one who died for me? Or am I living for myself? Am I living for my flesh? Am I living for the money? Am I living for what? Notoriety, the praise of man, the followers. What am I living for? The likes. What am I living for? Matthew 5, 14 and 16. Ye are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill and cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it what? Give light to the what? The whole house. Oh, so you mean if you would just turn that light on? Imagine what God will do. We're praying for him to come into our house. It says right here, thank you, Felicia, just turn on the light that God has already put in you and light the whole house. Whether that's your house, whether that's this house, light it up. We cannot just sit here and be dormant and go with the motion and go with the flow, because the flow leads us straight to hell if we're just going with the flow. If we're not resisting anything, if there's no effort in our lives, I would be very weary of going with the flow. Verse 16, let your light so shine before men that they would see your good works and like it, follow you, put you on a pedestal. Oh, let me get back. And glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Amen. Somebody's like, yeah, so they could do. Oh, wait, what? Oh, sorry. Okay, that's why we got to be careful. Because people will mix just a little bit of the word, especially you watching a lot of stuff. You're just watching it on Instagram. You're watching this. You don't know the person's background. You don't know anything about who this person is. They say a little scripture, and then they do what I just did, but they tie something else to the end of it. Yeah, you're running with that. You weren't like the Bereans who searched the word for themselves. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, the new has come. We got to walk in the word. We got to stand on the word. We got to be encouraged by the word when we are down in the dumps. Why have you disqualified you? That's the question. Why have you disqualified you? Somebody in here is sitting in their seat right now, and this word is speaking to them. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. The questions that are being asked are resonating with you. You know that this is for you. Why have you disqualified you? Is it insecurity? You don't feel like you're enough? God is calling you to do this thing, to serve over here, to be this, to do that, to launch that, to write this book, whatever it is that God's calling you to do. To join the women's ministry, to plug in, to show up more. You just know that God is calling you to take a step in Him. Do something. Trust me. But you feel like you're insecure. You feel like there's a lack of resources. Maybe that's what it is. Well, I would, but I don't know. I don't have no skills in that. I didn't go to school for that. I'm not qualified to do that. Past sin, faults, those true calls that we know that we did make. We did do those things. So now are we allowing that to just sit on our chest and that's who I am now? I'm wearing the scarlet letter. I'm no good for God or anything or anyone, and I'm just going to be that victim mindset. That's not what God has for you. Is it people pleasing? Is it fear? Is it family issues? Broken heart, guilt, shame, past trauma, hurt? Are you defiant? You're just not going to do it. Woo! Is it age? Are we saying we're too young? And if we are, we're probably not even saying that. We're just closed our ears. Many times when you're young, you just close your ears to things of God. because you're doing everything else, the TV, the social media, the this, the that, all these things. We have to open our ears to the things of God at every age. Tomorrow is not promised to none. We think that we'll do it when we're at a certain point. I'll do it when I'm 30, when I'm 40, when I'm 50, when I'm 60, when I'm 70, when I'm 80. And I think that if we have that mindset, when we're 30, when we're 40, when we're 50, when we're 60, we move it again. We just keep moving it. So we never get there. God forbid. So no matter what it is, none of our issues are bigger than God. None of the calls that we want to call where we want to disqualify ourselves, we want to throw a flag, we want to blow the whistle and say, nah, we're not cut out for this. Guess what? There's a scripture for that. Insecurity, lack of resources. We're going to kind of look at that in Moses. Faults and past sin. You want to look at that? You can see that in David. Family issues, opinions of man, past trauma, hurt. It's a lot we're going to see from Joseph. Fear you can see in Gideon. Guilt or shame, we can see it in the woman at the well. Defiance, we've been with Jonah a few months ago. We saw defiance. Age, Jeremiah, old, Moses. Any one of our doubts, fears, insecurities, excuses, whatever category you want to put it under, there's a scripture for that. It's nothing new under the sun. We're not the only one carrying that cross. But there's somebody who decided to pick it up. Are you going to pick it up today? Is today going to be the day when you say, I'm going to stop letting any of these things count me out of what God has planned for me since the beginning of time? Like we saw in the track race there. I'm not going to stop running because something happened or something went wrong. If anything, I might have to train harder. Are you willing to train harder? Are you willing to spend more time in the Word until you stop feeling that insecurity that you feel, that fear, but it's replaced with courage because you're sitting at your Father's feet? And when you get up, you're restored. When you get up, you walk different. When you get up, it's different when you spend time at His feet. You're not going to do that and then stay the same. So in Genesis 50 and 20, it says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. You gotta really put things into perspective, spiritual perspective. It is not to desensitize the things that we've been in our lives. It's not to say that we don't have deep hurts, deep pain, deep loss, all of these different situations, but it's to say that if you give it to God, He will turn it for your good, for the saving of many lives. That's it. If you stop trying to carry it on your own, if you stop trying to figure it out, if you stop letting it be your identity, and you break out of that, then God can turn it for your good, and He will. He will. So let's get into the Word. That's all the introduction, y'all. We're going to move quick. We're going to get in here to Exodus. Let's go to Exodus. Quickly. Just kidding. Exodus 3, though, is where we're going to go. Let me see. Okay, let me go quick here. Exodus 3. We're eating good today. Moses, in Exodus 3, he's a shepherd, okay? Remember, that's what he was doing. He was shepherding. In Exodus 3, 7 to 10, that's what we're going to read right now. 7, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you, Moses, to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. We're going to pause there. God is telling Moses what he has for Moses to do. Yes? Moses at that time is a shepherd. So you mean to tell me if you're out shepherding for the last 40 years and then God tells you, now I'm going to use you, not one of these warriors or, you know, kings or this or that, but I choose you, how might we respond? Sometimes I think we read the Bible, we get into the Word, and we could be like, oh, I can't believe he did that. You knew God and you still did this. You walking with him and and then it hits you. Ooh, me too. Me too. Where am I in all of this? And so if we look at how Moses responded, he made quite a few attempts to disqualify himself. If you go down verse 3 and 11, Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? How about you? What has God called you to do? And your response has been, who am I? Get somebody else to do it. That's how we feel. Pick somebody. Surely there's somebody better. So I'm going to stay in my seat because it looks like that person is doing a really good job doing it, and that person is doing a really good job doing it, not knowing that God didn't call them to do that. They're just doing it because they're waiting for you to get up and do what God called you to do so they can be free of that thing and do better at what God has called them to do. Excuse me. So too often we're too busy looking around at exterior situations and circumstances versus just being obedient to what God has called us to do. Let the rest of the chips fall where they may. The second thing he said, if we go down to Exodus 3 and 13, then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? So now, So now he's even questioning, first it's who am I, then it's what am I going to say, right? Who are they going to, why would they believe me, and who sent me? Oh, he's really, really analyzing this thing, y'all. He's a forward thinker. He's got the whole thing mapped out. When I go, hold on a second, let's think this through. Look, I skipped a part here, though, when he said I'm not enough or who am I. God's answer, he had already answered before the question. So it was in verse 3 and 11 where Moses said, who am I? But it was in verse 3 and 8 and 10 where God had already said, I have come down to deliver. God already said that he's going to do it. In verse 10, he said, come now, therefore, and I will send you. How do we know that if God is sending us, if God is calling us to do a thing, he's the one that's going to see it through? His word is not going to fail. But we put too much stake in ourselves. Who cares if you're not eloquent? Who cares if you're not a speaker? Who cares if you don't think you're a teacher? Who cares if you don't think you're an evangelist? Who cares if you don't think you can serve on the audio media ministry? Who cares? It's not about what we think that we can do. Do we know the God who can do all things? Do we know the God who can do all things? So we got to live like that. We got to stop relying on ourselves because apart from him, we can do nothing. So even what you think you can do on your own, you cannot do apart from him, and it will not last. 2 Corinthians, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Guys, it's because of the weakness that he's choosing you. The very thing that you're running from, that's why he wants it to be you. Because when they see it come through you, they're going to know who it was that sent you. Who it was that transformed you and set you free. Who it was that turned you around and took you out of that sin and that dysfunction and the labels and the false starts and put you on a new path. And they won't be able to do nothing but glorify God. Now we're going to look at verse, Let me see where I found myself. Okay, sorry. Verse 4 and 10. This was his other response. Then Moses said to the Lord, "Oh, my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither before nor since you have spoken to your servant, but I am slow of speech and slow of tongue." This is exactly what I was just talking about. Verse 11, though. So the Lord said to him, "Who has made man's mouth? Who makes the mute, the deaf, the seeing, or the blind? Have not I the Lord? Who has made your mouth?" We're sitting here getting caught up on what we think we can or cannot do. Who is the referee here? It is not you. I give you a hint. Okay? It is God himself that made you, that called you, that if he chose you, he's going to use you. He's not going to have you to fail or to stumble. He's going to complete what it is that he's going to complete through you if you just be willing vessel. That's all. That's only your responsibility. Be a willing vessel for his love. Be a willing vessel for his peace. Be a willing vessel for his joy. Be a willing vessel for God to use you. So Moses showed us a lot. And in each of his responses, we got to see how God responded. We gotta let that be a reminder to us when we get ready to hem and ha about why not. Let's go to Genesis 37 now. Who just loves to be in their Bible, just loves to be in the Word of God? Amen? This is good to me. I was just looking forward to this, just to get in God's Word together, just to break bread together. Genesis 37, we're looking at Joseph. Now, when we're looking at Joseph, I know a lot of y'all say, you know, you grew up rough. You might have had drama in the family. Some of y'all might know Joseph because I hear some people laugh and they're like, "Ooh." So if that's you, spend some time in Genesis 37 through about 44 when we leave here today. Because Joseph had it rough in his childhood, in his young adulthood. So when we get to verse 37, we're going to look at this, where he starts out. We're going to start out, I'm just going to read from verse 37, from verse 1. "Now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father." Now verse 3. "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his other children because he was the son of his old age," the baby. "Also, he made him a tunic of many colors." Now, you know they're starting to get a little jealous now. You know that's why kids wear school uniforms now. Okay, so everybody just dress the same, because you come in with your coat of many colors, they're going to start talking bad about you, who she thinks she is, who he think he is, right? He got his coat of many colors. Verse 4, "But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and couldn't even speak peaceably to him." Verse 5, "Now Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, 'Please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright, and indeed your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf.' And his brother said to him, 'Shall you reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us?' So they hated him even the more for his dreams and his words." Folks are going to hate when they see the favor of God over your life. Sometimes even family, even those closest to us, push back the most. But just like Joseph's dream, when God shows you a thing, he's showing you. Not everybody's going to believe it because he hasn't shown it to them. They can't see what you see, but you got to stand on what God has shown you. And as it went through, just for time's sake, I wanted to be able to read and get into it, but again, that's read it for yourself, be as the Bereans. But his brothers, they were going to kill him. His brothers were going to kill him. But instead, they sold him into slavery. We're talking childhood trauma here, right? And some in here can relate, whether it's betrayal, heartbreak, pain, loss, abandonment. But as much as we relate here with his pain that he's experiencing because of this deep betrayal from his family, we got to relate to the fact that Joseph's story of his life did not end there. It didn't end in the thing that happened to him. Don't let it end in the thing that happened to you either. We get to Genesis 39 and 2. Joseph was sold as a slave. He's now in Egypt. Joseph, verse 39 and 1. Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, brought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. Verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph. Verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph in the midst of it all. And he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian, and his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and served him. Then he made him overseer of his house, and all that he had he put under his authority. So it was from that time he had made him overseer of his house and all that he had that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field. The Lord is with you too. His plan is to lift you up out of the pit, out of the mess, out of the brokenness, out of the dysfunction, out of the drama, out of the world of sinful cycles, that he would be glorified in your life. But see, you got to believe that for yourself. You got to trust God for yourself. And it's not something that just happens. It comes through you walking with him day in and day out in the small things, in the still quiet moments of your day. Genesis 39 and 8. We're just moving through this. Genesis 39 and 8. But he refused because his master's wife tried to commit adultery with him. Try to seduce him, yes. And many a man would have been for that. They would have went with that. A beautiful woman trying to seduce you, but not Joseph. He refused and said to his master's wife, look, my master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. There is no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and what? Sin against God. How do we live our lives? Where is our identity found? How do we gauge what we're going to do in a situation? Because of how we feel, because of what we want, because of what the world says, because of what everybody else is doing? Or do we think to ourselves, how could I? How even could I do this thing against God? Because we go through our lives and we don't think about who God is. We don't think about what he's done for us in our lives, that he sent his son to die on the cross to hang for our sins, that we could be saved and spend eternity with him. And we don't let that lead, guide, and direct our day-to-day living. We let it just be a thing that happened. We disconnect ourselves from it. Let that not be so, because you're disconnecting yourself from God when you do that. Genesis 39, 8 and 10. I'm sorry, honoring God in our lives, living for him, righteousness, being holy, set apart. And as you go through the whole journey of Joseph's life, it is incredible how God moves through his life. It's incredible. In chapter 40, we learn of the time when Joseph was in prison and there was a situation where there was a butler and a baker, and they want to know what their dreams meant. Joseph says in verse 40 and 8, do not interpretations belong to God? You see how Joseph lives? He's not trying to ever get glory for himself. It's always pointing to God. Amen. Tell me your dreams. He ends up interpreting their dreams for them. He simply asked the cupbearer, the butler, in verse 40 and 14, but remember me when it is well with you, and please show kindness to me. Make mention of me to Pharaoh and get me out of here. I have done nothing to deserve being in this prison. Now in verse 40, 23, do we think that the butler remembered him? Nope. Yet the chief butler did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. So again, this is one of those false start moments that Joseph had many opportunities in his life to be discouraged and let his discouragement disqualify him. Be angry, be bitter, be hateful, be spiteful, be depressed, be sad, be broken, be all of these things. Now these people, I just did them this solid. I interpreted their dreams, God, I let you use me. I just knew that was going to be my way out. And they forgot about him. Then in 41, 46, Joseph was 30 years old, and when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and Joseph went out for the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land. Now in the 7 plentiful years, the ground brought forth abundantly. So he gathered up all the food of the 7 years, which were in the land of Egypt, and laid up the food in the cities. He laid up every city the food of the fields which surrounded them. Joseph gathered very much grain as the sand of the sea until he stopped counting, for it was immeasurable. And before I finish this, before we got here, because I skipped something in my notes, So 7 years of great abundance came, followed by 7 years of great famine. He lays out this plan. Again, he's getting favor. He's constantly has God's favor throughout this whole his whole walk. He's being favored by God. But in Genesis 42, his brothers, now in the famine part, they have to find their way to Egypt because their father sends them there to buy grain so they don't starve. This is when it comes full circle, y'all. It comes full circle because it's a little bit of a long story, and I can't give it all to you. But what happens is his brothers come back to him. Now, he could have just got vengeance and just had them all killed, or he could have done anything. But instead, because of God's favor in Joseph's life, and he does scare him a little bit, y'all. He does play some tricks on him and get him a little nervous that something's going to happen to the little brother and their father's heart is going to be broken. There's a lot that goes on in there. However, where it ends up is where I want us to go before we close. Verse 45, verse 3 and 8. Chapter 45, thank you. Chapter 45, verse 3 to 8. Then Joseph said to his brothers, this is when he revealed himself to his brothers, because they didn't even recognize him now. They didn't even recognize the brother that they sold into slavery. Let me make sure we know that part. They were begging him, please don't keep the little brother, because he had created a situation where he was going to keep now the youngest. And they're begging him, please don't keep the youngest brother. Our father will surely die because he's already lost his other son, the one that's standing right in front of them that they sold away. So now in verse 3, then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? But his brothers couldn't answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. Imagine, they're shocked. They're guilty. They're probably afraid now. Whoa, my, how the tables have turned. Verse 4 and or 5, but now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. Why? For God sent me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvesting, and God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So listen, it was not you, it was not them, it was not whoever or whatever happened to you. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and the Lord of all his house and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Even those who hated him ended up being blessed by him because of Joseph's walk with God. His family was blessed. 45:16, Joseph's brothers have come, and it pleased Pharaoh and his servants well. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, say to your brothers, do this, load your animals and depart and go to the land of Canaan. Bring your father and your household and come to me. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt, and you will eat the fat of the land. Now, everything happened just as Joseph dreamed that it would back in that original dream when we read in verse 37 and 7 through 8 that his brothers would bow to him. Little did they know the very thing that angered them, that turned their backs on him, that caused them to resent him, was the very thing that was going to save their life in the end. So many of us get caught up on the journey, the experiences, the things that happen to us, and we don't leave room for the next chapter. We want to just stay in that chapter, in that misery chapter, in that broken chapter, in that hurting chapter. And we don't understand that we just got to keep turning the page. God has more for us. God has more for us. Who you are is who God says you are. Amen. Praise God. You are who Jesus hung, died, and rose again for you to be. You are who the Holy Spirit in you empowers you to be. You are who God's grace covers you to be. Each time we encounter God, we ought to go away different. I pray that today we go away different, that we go forward, change, transform, set free, that we go forward walking in the truth of the word of God, not the lie of the enemy. No more. No more will my identity be associated with what I've done, what's been done to me, none of it. We're going to go forward with peace in our mind, forward with love in our hearts, confident in our spiritual walk, not in ourselves, but in the God who created us. Nothing you've done, this is what I'm going to leave you with, nothing you've done is bigger than what Jesus did on the cross for you and for me. Let it go. Release it. Take that boulder off your back, off your chest. Breathe again and walk in the freedom of Christ. Thank God for his mercy. Thank God for his grace. Thank God for his favor. Thank him for it. And then live like you thank him for it. Nothing that's been done to you is bigger than what Jesus did when he gave his life for you and for me. Nothing. Nothing. So, again, as we leave here today, remember that we're not the referee. We're not the one that's called to make the call in our life, whether we're qualified or we're disqualified, whether we're in or whether we're out. We're in because God said we're in. We're in because he wrote our name in the book of life. So we're in. You're already in the game. The question is, are you going to play? Are you going to run the race? Are you going to finish strong? How are you going to train? So you can be ready when the gun shoots, you can be ready to run your race. Amen? Amen. I got this song that I'm going to play for us as we go out of here. Praise God. Thank you, sister. I just thank God for the word. I pray that it's received in our hearts. I pray that each and every single one of us in this room today know that we are not our past. We're not locked into anything that the enemy tries to hold against us, Heavenly Father. Just thank you for the truth, Lord God. We thank you for your mercy and for your grace, Heavenly Father. We thank you that we are who you say that we are, and that is it, Lord God. Help us to walk in the truth of your word. Help us to get to know your word, Heavenly Father, to hunger for your word, to thirst for your word, to understand that our identity is wrapped up in you, Heavenly Father. You are the referee. We give you the whistle. We pray that you would call out our next play, Heavenly Father. We just thank you. We love you. We honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Oh, yeah. Come on, give God some praise for the word this morning. Very present now word.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
Very present and a now word. Let's listen for a couple of minutes. Let's listen. Yes.
You had it figured out.
Yes.
And it was all working
you, Lord,
for my good.
Thank you, Lord.
If only I knew back then, mm-hmm, what I know right now.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank God this morning. Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah this morning. We thank God for the word this morning. Thank God for the encouragement this morning. Amen. We need the word, and we need to be encouraged sometimes. Sometimes we can be our own worst enemy. Amen. Sometimes we allow the enemy to whisper in our spirit that we're not going to be able to overcome. Amen. That we live, that we are alive. We do live defeated. No, we don't live defeated. Amen. And so we thank God for the word this morning. Amen. And once again, you know, we're living in a time where we have to be reminded constantly of who God says we are. Amen. We have to live that. We have to begin to live that, and we need to be reminded. We do need the accountability. We need to recognize that, hey, we are one another's keeper. Amen? We have to have that. We have to have that. And, you know, the way the favor of God works, it only works in your obedience. It only works in when we're obedient to the word of God. It doesn't happen without that. There's some things that we have to do. You have to become diligent. You have to become faithful. God want to know if he can trust you. How many of you know that? He want to know if he can trust you. That happens from one level of failure to the next level of triumph. Amen? God wants to know. Now, the enemy, we have an adversary who doesn't want to see us become those overcomers. Amen? We have an adversary. So we need one another. We need the body of Christ. And we're living in a time now. We're living in a time where there's a form of godliness in the church. And many, many, many are living lives that you're failing, but you're not failing. Your failure has nothing to do with God. Your failure has to do with you. Amen. You're not the referee now. You're not the referee. And so, once again, we want to kind of just look within our own hearts and what are those areas that you're failing? What are those areas that you're not operating according to the word of God and who God says you are? Amen. It is who God says I am. Amen. It is truly who God says we are. So let's continue to be faithful to be doers of the word. Amen. You're only going to see the victory through what was taught today, through obedience. You're only going to see it through obedience. You're not even going to discern the things of God, spiritual things of God, without the application. Amen. You got to become doer. We all have to become doers. And we do need accountability. We need somebody to say something to us every now and then. Amen? So we thank God for using Minister LaCrea today and the word. Amen? Come on, give God praise today. You might have to go back and listen to that again later on this afternoon or later on in the week to really, really let it saturate into your thoughts. And we do need to all ask ourselves. Have you asked yourself, who am I? Who are you? Who are you? Then the question was, who does God say you are? Because that's where the rubber meets the road. Amen? It's who God knows who we are, who I am. It's not who I say I am. God knows who we are. So let's take what was shared with us today. Amen? Let's take what was given to us today. Amen? We thank God for all our guests today. We pray that again that you've been encouraged. We will be here this Tuesday. Online for our men and women Bible study. We'll be here in the physical building Wednesday for our Bible study. Minister Eric's going to pick back up. Let's continue to pray one for another. Amen. Is there anybody that needs to make a decision? I'm going to keep it real simple. Anybody need to make a decision for the Lord today? Recommit your life. Amen. Anybody in need, you don't have a church home and you've been seeking and asking God to lead you someplace where you can learn and grow and be discipled. Is that anybody? Slide your hand up. Is that anybody? The Lord is calling you to this church, to this family. Amen. Keep it really simple today. Amen. Praise God. Listen, let's keep praying one for another. We'll see you this week. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you again for the word today. Father, may we never be the same because of what we heard today. But Lord, let us, it has to translate out into what we do. Hallelujah. We have to be doers of the word and not hearers only. Special blessing again on our guests. A special blessing, Lord, again on all that you have done. Let us continue to be faithful to you. Keep our eyes on you and looking to you, Father. Let us live a governed by the word of God life. We must be governed by your word. Amen. And so thank you, Lord, again. Blessings to all on your way home. Get home safely. We'll see you Tuesday. We'll see you Wednesday. God bless you.